Welcome to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, presented by Yamaha.
Welcome back to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. I'm Bree Gabrielle and this is Captain Rick Murphy, and we are taking you around Florida to find out what's biting this weekend. But first, Rick, let's say hi to Captain Dave Farrell over at the workbench,
who
there
is
he
a
is.
How you doing,
master
guys?
Baiter over there.
Yeah,
hey.
That's me, all right, for sure. Dave, so you're going to be talking about bait. Yes, we are. We're going to be talking about bait, and we're going to talk about dead bait this time. We usually talk about live bait, but now we're going to talk about some dead baits.
Yes, well, we are talking about bait because no one can fish on credit. Right, Rick? Well, maybe you can.
No,
I think
I got
you
no
can.
Credit.
Yeah, you can. You're probably really great at it.
You know what? Let's get into the theme, Bree. You're right. Bait fishing is certainly something that all the guys around the state do. Here's my little man, Ridge, throwing the cast net.
Oh.
Whether it's netting pilchards, whether it's netting finger mullet, a lot of guys use bait. It's certainly one of the most popular ways to fish throughout the state of Florida. And filling the live well on the Pathfinder is certainly something you're going to want to do. Pilchards are probably the most popular bait during this time of year. And we'll get more into it, as you can know. We're going to talk about ballyhoos with Dave, and he's going to show us pre-rigged packages that you can go with any place in the world.
Ballyhoo throwing
ballyhoos.
All right, let's talk bait first with Jeffrey Page, who's quite the catch himself in the Central West region. Hey, Page.
Hey, you guys.
Hey.
You know, in the Startron Central West region, we have a variety of live bait and a variety of ways to catch it. First, probably the most popular, I heard Rick mention it, is the cast net. Comes in a variety of sizes. Most popular and easiest to throw are your 6 to 8 foot light lead line. When I say light lead line, I mean a pound to a pound and a half per foot. Works well in shallower waters, less than 5 feet, such as the grass flats along the beaches, sandy areas. Second is your mesh size. And for the shallow waters flats areas, you're gonna want a 1/4 inch or a 3/8 inch. 1/4 inch is gonna avoid getting any of the smaller species gilled in the mesh. 3/8 is going to get you a little bit quicker sink time. You're going to catch those bigger pilchards and nicer pinfish. It's going to get your pinfish, your pilchards, your grunts, ballyhoo, small thread. Now for the bigger thread fins in your deeper, stronger current areas like bridges and passes, you're going to need a 10 to 12 foot net with a 1 3/4 pound to 2 pound per foot 5/8 mesh, which allows that water to flow through that net quicker and get to the bottom quicker. One other tip for cast netters, especially on the flat, you can mix up a batch of chum like we did, Rick, when we shot Sportsman's Adventure last year. That'll gather up the pilchards into the area you're throwing, and then you'll get more per throw. Next, sabiki rigs work real well in 12 to 25 feet of water, especially around range markers, just outside your inlets or your passes. There you're going to get your thread fins, your big pilchards, pinfish, Spanish sardines, and cigar minnows. And last, probably the most fun, is a dip net. Long handle dip net. You can be on the passes, on the outgoing tides, and dip your tarpon crab. Or at night, you can be around dock lights, bridge lights, or hang a lantern off the bow of your boat and dip shrimp. I've got a couple photos this evening. For your average angler that has a hard time catching bait in my region, I've got a couple young guys named Ben and Mike that run M&M Bait Company out of Bradenton Beach. They've got a commercial boat. They go early in the morning, they catch their bait, and they fill that big 100-gallon tub, sometimes two of them, with pilchards, and you can meet them right there at Kingfish Boat Ramp at Anna Maria Island by the Manatee Avenue Bridge, and they'll sell you scoops of bait for the guy that has a hard time catching it.
All right, Paige, we're going to take a look at the Navionics from your region. Now, certainly, it's very important to know exactly where to start, and Navionics actually tells us that this week. Now, certainly, we're talking about Lido Key right in Paige's region. Now, up tight to the beach there, you're going to find a lot of pilchards. But as you drop off here along this edge, what you're going to also find is the thread fins. Now, also remember, guys, that all of the passes here on those hill tides, as they start to go out the tide, the crabs are going to flood out of there, and you can dip your crabs for whether you're permit fishing or tarpon fishing. All right, Paige, what else do you have for us in the Central West region?
Just where you mentioned, lots of snook along the beaches there at both sides of Big Pass and New Pass along that Lido Key, Longboat Key area. Early morning, you're going to be able to catch them on topwater pugs. And at sunset, around the mullet schools and the bait schools, One area down south outside of Catfish Creek and Widdens Creek. Also the oyster bars in Palmasola and Terracea Bay. Ski alley, rag alley in the Stump Pass area. But probably the most effective way to get your snook right now in this warmer water condition has been with that filtered free line along the beaches and in our inlets. I got a photo tonight of some longtime clients of mine, Keith and Carrie Ann Meyer from Wisconsin, with a big snook they got Tuesday morning with me.
Well, that's a good one, Jeffrey. All right, let's go offshore.
Red snapper, well, the red snapper season was short and sweet, with just about everyone that went out after them scoring big with their limits easily taken. The red snappers range, the area where they were getting them good was 90 feet on out. Lots of the bigger fish coming off hard bottom and ledges in that 140 feet, 160 foot range. Every captain told me that frozen sardines seemed to work just as well as a live pinfish, but most of them came prepared with both and had no trouble getting their limits. Species two, amberjack. Big AJ still burning up drags on the wrecks and ledges in 90 to 140 feet of water. Big pinfish, grunts, or the Williamson's Vortex jig in hot pink. AJs are averaging 15 to 35 pounds.
All right, Jeffrey, tell me about some CCA photos that you got here before we get to the hot spots.
All right, our friend Lisa Fitzgerald sent me those, and that is the proper way to measure your species. Everybody wants to catch a tagged redfish and win an instant big prize, but there's other categories being snook, which has to be legal, trout, which has to be legal, so the snook has to be 28 inches or over, trout has to be 15 or over, so those are their own separate categories. But then there's a conservation category, Rick, flounder, snapper, jack, ladyfish, catfish, etc., and all you have to do is lay it on that measuring ruler that you can get at a lot of different places. Once you're legally signed up, you lay your fish on there like you see in the photo, snap your cell phone, which will have the app, CCA Star app, and boom, you're in.
All right, thank you, Jeffrey. We're going to go ahead and look at the sea sucker hotspots from the Central West region. Captain Page says, inshore tarpon, up and down the beaches in the entire region. Live freeline crab, still the best bet. And then offshore, mangrove snapper. Lots of quality-sized mangs holding on the wrecks and ledges in 90 to 110 feet of water. Live pinfish or pilchards is going to be the best bet.
All right, Rick, let's move on a little south into the southeast region where Ronnie Houston has all the bait info you'll need. Right, Ronnie?
Yes, ma'am, there, Bree. You know, when it comes to bait, generally the wintertime pattern as the weather cools, both inshore and offshore, the most common bait used in the region is shrimp. Whether it's tipped on bucktails, knocker rigs, or under cork. But it can be used actually all throughout the year. Now, early spring through late fall, most guys will use pilchards, thread fins, pinfish, and cut baits like ladyfish, mullet, and catfish tails. All these baits will basically catch your snook, your redfish, your trout, your tarpon, and snapper on the inshore side. But on the offshore side, the pilchards, thread fins, pinfish, grunts, sardines will catch most of your groupers, snappers, and amberjacks as well. Now, believe it or not, the more smell your bait has, the better chances you have to catch a variety of the red groupers and the gag groupers, and those baits are to include cut squid, cut thread fins, cut sardines, and believe it or not, certain times of the year, live crabs are the number one bait used for permit and tarpon, which is going on great right now, and this is the perfect time of the year and for the next couple months to be using the live crab. Now, whether you can go out and try to catch these baits and learn on your own, it can be as simple as most baits can generally be bought at most tackle shops, or like I say, you go out and catch them on your own. But still on the inshore side, the redfish. Now this week, there's good tides up in the northern end of the region with good incoming water getting really high. Now you want to try to zone in on the water and fish large stretches of depressions and potholes along the east wall from Alligator to Two Pine, Smokehouse to Boquilla, and the west wall. Now, the little trick right here that seems to be working better, I was just up there for a couple days doing this, try to fish the water that's not so clean. We haven't really had an abundance of rain, which those rivers will be pushing out the fresh water. So try to fish the water that's a little dingy, but you can still make out the potholes and these depressions. Once you get into a zone like that, live pilchards and pinfish, also the Bass Assassin 4-inch sea shad, and mud bugs, Houdini, Skunk Monkey and Watermelon on 8th to 16th ounce jig head. Also gold spoons and top water plugs. Specific colors have been chrome or white in color. Fan cast those top waters, but believe it or not, the artificial seem to work better for me, and the typical size of the fish we were catching were anywhere from 19 to 30 inches. Now, on the offshore side, the red groupers, you want to concentrate. Right now, the bite is good all through the region, and believe it or not, sure keepers are in depth right now of 60 to 90 feet, hard bottom and ledges, big pieces or small pieces, both will work. Now, the best baits right now have been the pinfish, the grunts, cut herring, squid, or white 4 to 6 ounce bucktails with glowworms or with squid. And a prime example, over the weekend, we had the third annual Ronald McDonald Charity Tournament, which there was a 4-fish total weight limit. Now, Team Sunset Air won with 182 pounds, and the first picture I've got should be a 23-pound red grouper caught in that tournament, which was the biggest red grouper caught in that specific division. But in the 4-fish total weight division, there was a black grouper that was caught, 124 and a quarter pounds, by Jason Schreier, Jordan Mendez, Lou Santagata, Danny Watkins, Eli Mendez, and Captain Alex Newman. Now, up until the weekend when I got this report, that is a pending state and possibly an IGAFA world record. Now, like I'm saying, the southwest coast of Florida is a good place to fish for groupers right now. It's on fire. Also on the offshore side, the permit. With the moderate weather, most wrecks and towers as close as 8 miles, but up to 40 miles are holding large schools and double-digit numbers of permit from Marco to Sanibel. So run and gun, drifting across or anchoring up, be impatient to wait for these fish. You can also chum, catch plenty of snapper while waiting for the permit. The bait of choice has been live shrimp, bright-colored bucktail, tip, but the number one bait has been live crabs. I've got a prime example of a fish that was caught in the region. Eduardo Rumbos, fishing out of Chokoloski Island Park, fishing one of the offshore wrecks down in the Everglades. That, and believe it or not, that fish was caught on artificial. And don't forget, guys, you don't have to wait till Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night to get this report. Go to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report website. We're updating all through the week what species is going on and where to catch these fish, but also look for the new thing we're going to have going on, not only a fishing report, but a new weather update for the weekend.
All right, great job, Ronnie. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the hot spots, which is the Florida Outdoor Experience inshore hot spots. Snook tarpon along most of the beaches and passes all throughout the region. Outgoing tide has been the best bet using live pilchards and crabs. And in offshore, Spanish mackerel, king mackerel, fish in the wrecks 5 to 15 miles out using live threadfin, blue runners, silver spoons, and white bucktails. Now, we want to take a look at the hummingbird shot of the week. And I'm going to tell you, one of the things that we're all talking about right now is certainly tarpon fishing. So if you have a 360 that's built into this hummingbird unit, what it allows you to do is take a 360-degree look while you're sitting on anchor. This is what we traditionally do. We'll set it up with two different looks. We'll have the sonar here, which is marking the tarpon. But then, as you can see, by looking at it 360, we're able to look out on both sides of the boat. We're looking at a 95-foot range times two, which would be on both sides, looking a total of 180-plus feet. So that's a real cool way to do it. Bree, what's another great way to look around for the tarpon in this state?
Well, I'm sorry. I'm still focused on the grouper. I think we need to go grouper fishing in the southwest region with Ronnie Houston. That's what I think. All right, guys, we've got a lot more talk and shop to do. And when we come back, we're visiting the southeast region and then going off the deep end with Dave. How's it looking at the workbench, Dave?
It looks good over here. We're going to do some bait stuff.
It's always looking good. All right, we'll see you later.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Chevrolet. Find new roads. Yamaha. Reliability starts here. Contender Boats, performance through innovation. Hummingbird, simply, clearly, better. Decks and Docks Lumber Company, Florida's dock and seawall supplier. And King Sailfish Mounts, www.kingsailfish.com.
When we created the Silverado Rally Edition, we figured, why stop there? These four new Silverado Special Editions are just the beginning. from this year's fastest-growing full-size truck brand, Chevy Silverado. Or choose this Silverado All-Star with a total value of $8,000 when you finance through select lenders. And find your bonus tag and get an additional $1,000 to $2,000 cash allowance on select vehicles in stock.
Yamaha's next-generation V6 four-strokes are changing the game.
Mid-range power was awesome.
Fuel the burn. It's unbelievable.
Couldn't believe the speed and the fuel economy. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, I couldn't believe the power. It was like a... just... I was more like doing a quarter mile on a drag strip.
And them things are like, it's a whole other day.
So I made the switch.
Experience the difference for yourself during the Yamaha Discover V6 Offshore Demo Tour. See why we call it the game changer.
It's been said that a bad day of fishing is better than a good day at the office. But down here in the Florida Keys, we have to disagree. Because with over 200 of the world's best charter boat captains and guides, there's no such thing as a bad day of fishing. The Florida Keys and Key West.
Time for the FWC News and Notes. June 27th, there's a kids fishing clinic in Cape Canaveral. July 11th, there's another kids fishing clinic in Palm Coast. Lucky kitties. For more information, visit myfwc.com. But now it's time to go off the deep end.
Well, we're over here at the CCA workbench, and hummingbird certainly helps us find bait, Dave. We're here talking about bait this week, so let's talk about it.
Well, I'm talking about finding it right in the groceries freezer. You know, sometimes you go and find it. I'm going to talk a little bit. We usually talk about live bait all the time on this segment. Over the years, we've talked a lot about caring for live bait and whatnot. Figure this time we'll talk a little about caring for dead baits and what to look for when you're going out to buy them, because that's what most of our fellas are doing when they're coming out here trolling. They're going, they're buying their dead baits, you know, at the store. So the boys at Baitmaster sent us some nice baits here to look at and sent us some tips on telling us what to look for. For one thing, almost all the ballyhoo used all over the world that they ship all around comes from the little spot between Miami and Key West. They're all out there in that offshore area, and there's two different kinds of ballyhoo out there that they target. The regular little ballyhoos, which is this one right here, which has the orange tips and the orange tails, which is what you want to look for when you're going to buy your bait. You're wanting the bright orange tip and the bright orange tail. And they also have one that has the red. Now a red tip and a red tail. We don't have any of those here, thank goodness. They're the less desirable of the ballyhoo. They're called the balau. And what happens, you'll catch those in the deeper water, and they're a little softer and more fragile than the ones that they catch, the real ballyhoos here that they catch inshore.
Uh-huh.
And those are, you know, the really ones to use for the bait.
You know, the thing I like about this, Dave, is that you can buy, maybe you're not as an experienced, you don't know how to rig, you can buy stuff, to me it looks like, that's already pre-rigged.
Oh yeah, you can buy ballyhoos rigs, you can buy squid rigs, mackerel rigs, you even got a swordfish rig over there. And you know, you're right. If you can also cut the little loops off these things and slide any kind of lure down you want to on top of them. But what you're really wanting to do is when you go out to look at them, you're wanting to find a guy who's been giving you consistent baits time and again. You want to find bait that's packaged correctly. It's not all folded up and messed up. There's no freezer burn on it. Usually when you can tell right away if bait's been in there a long time. There's gaps and voids in the wrapper and there's freezer burn on the bait. Stay away from those baits. You want all the fins to be intact. You don't want to buy your ballyhoos and have all the fins and this is a mackerel. You don't want your ballyhoos or your mackerels to have the fins broken, because when you have the fins broken off, it can affect how the baits swim. And you want all the scales and everything to be on, because the scales actually protect the bait when it's swimming. If all its scales are gone, it's going to wash out faster. You want to keep them out of fresh water.
You know what I noticed too, mm-hmm. is a lot of times when you go in and you're buying pre-packaged stuff, mm-hmm. it's not silver. It's got a yellowish tint to it.
Right.
It's old and it's...
It needs to be bright. The eyeballs need to be clear, just like if you were buying fish to eat. You know, you don't want to buy stuff that's been, you know, sitting around for a long time. And what you want to do is, as soon as you get them, you put them in a bucket, let them thaw out in salt water.
Right.
Pull them out of there. You know, as soon as they're thawed, rinse them in salt water. Do whatever rigging you want to do to them. Put lures on top of them, whatever, and then lay them on top of the ice, but not touching the ice. You have to have a bait tray or a nice bit of aluminum foil to lay down on top of the ice, and then put your baits on it, and then salt it. Because if you put your bait on the fresh water, it'll make them go down faster and faster and faster, and your bait won't last.
You did good.
Well, you know, that's one thing.
I got to use
a lot of these prepackaged ballyhoos this weekend. You know, fishing up in Cape Canaveral during the FSFA tournament.
Did you catch anything?
I wasn't in the tournament, but we did catch a nice little wahoo.
Oh, cool.
So, you know, hey, it was on wire. So.
Speaking of that, you know, Dave, King Sailfish every 3 weeks or so has been providing us with some data tagging report.
Well, this is the King Sailfish tagging report.
So let's go ahead and take a look.
Well,
this
like
week.
We said, you know, the Billfish Foundation, you know, they do a lot of tagging of billfish. They track the movements of the billfish and how much they weigh when they put a tag in them. And so they've been doing that since 1990. And if you look at this little thing we have up here, that's 220,000 people have put tags in fish since 1990.
Wow.
You know, and that's like 140,000 anglers. So, but as many as they have got on there, you see that the recovery, we only recovered 77 in the last year, only 3,000 since 1990. So we need more people tagging. You need to put tags in fish, and because the more tags we have out there, the more we get back. And this week's tagging report recognizes Chris Conklin. He caught a sailfish with Bouncer
right
up there, and just recently, an Atlantic sail on Bouncer's Dusky. And that's a fish track map, and you can see where they got the tag where that fish was caught. But on this map, what's really cool is it's a chlorophyll map. So you can see the green areas of the blue areas. The more green it is, the more chlorophyll. And you'll find a lot of the billfish species and stuff will be on the edge of the chlorophyll and the deep blue
Yeah, they don't
water.
Like the green
no,
water.
You know,
they like the blue.
That's right. They, you know, that nutrient-rich water holds the bait. But you want it, the sailfish and the billfish, they want to be on that edge.
That's great but, yeah. stuff by Fish Track.
Yep, but Conklin, he's got, and you can go on there and you get free stuff. And this is Phil and Chris, you know, when they tag the sail, they put the tag right there.
You can see the tag right
yep,
there.
Yep, put it up
dorsal?
In the upper back. You want it, no, you don't want it in the dorsal fin. You want it in the upper back, you know, above the lateral line and not in the gills or anywhere near the head or the eyeball.
Right.
Because if you go in or below his lateral line, it'll get into his guts. So, you know, you don't want to do that either.
And then last but not least.
Well, this is the Billfish top junior angler, release angler, Jonathan Gaskill. He won the 2014 11 through 12 division. You know, so we got the young guys out there tagging fish. If we got more of these fellas out there tagging, we'll get more returns. And you can go out to billfish.org and look all those things up and, you know, track your own fish once you tag them.
And Jonathan, next week's our kids show, so you need to come down to the studio and maybe share some of that cool stuff.
Rick will give you something.
Yeah.
Rick will give you something. Nice.
I'll give you 5 minutes to talk. I'll give you 5 minutes to talk to Bree. And speaking of 5 minutes, looking at my Guy Harvey Tag Heuer watch tells me that it's time.
Power.
Oh, tag you are. Power. You're wearing the tag
for a new region.
All right, coming to you from the Southeast region is Jimbo Thomas, ready to give you the weekend report for some great fishing.
That's right, Bree, and hello, Rick and Dave. Now, yeah, here in the Southeast region, we're really lucky to have such a great variety and abundance of bait. A block of chum and a few sabikis or a cast net, that's all you need to fill that live well up. Or you can take the easy route and break out the wallet and buy the bait from one of the many bait boats that work around any of the inlets throughout the region. There's a lot of popular spots to catch bait throughout the region. Blue Heron Bridge and Lake Worth, around any of the fishing piers along the coast, also around any of the inlets, the navigation markers and buoys, as well as the numerous bait patches. Bait patches, some are secret, some are not. The most common baits are threadfin herrings, pilchards, goggle eyes, sardines, cigar minnows, blue runners, speedos, ballyhoo, and tenfish,
and pretty much anything else in between. And we use our depth machine to locate the bait, or we put out some ground chum and then we let the bait find us. The sabiki rig is the preferred way to catch the bait, and we only use a cast net when they won't eat the sabiki or if we're on a big school of pilchers and want to load up the well with pilchers. Otherwise, sabiki is the way to go. When we do use the cast net, it kind of beats the bait up, and they don't live or last near as long as the sabiki caught bait. And aboard the Thomas Flyer, we use R&R tackle, PG7 sabikis, but any good sabiki rig will work. And then the bait in the southeast region, especially in the Miami area, that it hasn't been really good lately. Everybody's had to work a lot harder for a lot less bait. Nobody really knows why, but we assume it's because of the dredging and government cut, and that's had the water really silted up for the last year and a half. But when that project is over and the water gets back to normal, hopefully the bait will too. Now, we have been catching them, but it's just been a little more work than usual. Now, staying inshore, there's still some great largemouth bass fishing to be had in the Everglades conservation areas. We haven't had any rain to speak of, which means the water levels are still low, concentrating those bass in the canals and the deeper holes. Fishing the late morning and afternoon, catches of up to 50 fish a trip have been common using live shiners, Rapala floating minnows, and swimming ribbon tail worms. Then a little closer to home, the urban canal systems have been producing both peacock and largemouth bass. With the warm weather, the peacock bass has been biting like crazy on the artificial and live bait. And then Rapala shad wraps and DOA jerk baits work extra fast have also been getting a lot of bites along with the live minnows and shiners. Now moving offshore, dolphin fishing has been consistent all week. With this calm weather that we've had, it's been easy to spot any fish activity or anything floating on the surface. There's been schoolies in the 4 to 6 pound range, anywhere from 4 to 8 miles offshore, which is in the 400 to 1,000 foot range, especially off the Miami area. The fish have been around scattered weed lines, and most of the fish have had birds working over the top of them, both frigate birds and terns. Now, some of these days, the weed has been so scattered, it's been nearly impossible to troll through. So we've been spotting the fish under frigate birds and terns, and we've been pitching live pilchers and cut baits to these dolphins. And then when the weed hasn't been too bad, enabling us to troll, we've been using rig ballyhoo, small lures, and feathers. And it's been working fairly decent, but you just got to be able to keep those lures clean. And then anything of size floating has also been holding fish. And most of the larger fish, and there's been fish up to 40 pounds caught in the last week, they've been traveling to the south and found under the frigate bird. And then in a little closer to shore, along the edge of the Gulf Stream, blackfin tuna are still being caught on live herring and pilchers, drifted or fished under the kite, in 120 to 250 feet of water. And the best bite has been late in the afternoon. And if there's any overcast conditions, the bite has been throughout the day. And if you go with light 30 to 40 pound fluorocarbon leaders and small hooks, that will get you the most bites. And most of these blackfin tunas have been in the 25 to 30 pound range.
All right, great report from the Captain Harry Southeast Region. Jimbo, we're gonna go ahead and take a look at the First National Bank of South Florida hotspots. Captain Jimbo says fish the urban canals with live minnows and artificials for peacock and largemouth bass. And then offshore, search for the dolphin offshore under the birds. Look for the weeds and debris with trolled ballyhoo. And you might want to use lures or live or cut bait.
You can't even bait a hook.
Nope.
You know that song?
Nope.
Justin
Moore?
No, of course you don't. That's all right. Well,
it's like I don't ever watch movies.
You know, you don't. You don't even know any Finding Nemo references. What's wrong with you? All right, who's ready to go fishing? Are you ready to go fishing?
Yeah.
Always ready to go fishing.
That's what's wrong with me. I'm always fishing.
Stick around because in just a few moments, we're seeing what the Northeast and the East regions have to offer right here on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. Yay.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Bass Assassin and Saltwater Assassin, the best lures, period. Blue Water Outriggers, everything for your outdoor adventures. Guy Harvey Clothing by AFTCO. Drummond Community Bank. Costa Sunglasses, see what's out there. And Casa Vieja Lodge, five-star angling in beautiful Guatemala.
I'm Captain Rick Murphy, and I'm a life member of CCA. Why am I so involved with CCA, you ask? Because I want our fisheries to be in better shape for my kids and their kids. CCA is working to ensure the future of recreational fisheries and the rights of recreational anglers. The future of fishing starts today with you. How do you want to leave things with your kids? If you're like me, you'll want to make the right choice and go to joinccaflorida.com right now.
Guatemala.
Can a truck change how people feel about a guy? We talk to real people, not actors. We showed them two pictures of the same guy in the same location. The only difference? The vehicle behind him.
The guy with the truck would definitely have like a German Shepherd dog. I mean, come on.
Like a tarantula.
A rattlesnake.
What kind of pet would this guy have?
Maybe like some birds.
You know you want a truck. The all-new Chevy Colorado. Motor Trend's 2015 Truck of the Year.
You know, Bree, we have to have maintenance on these Yamahas and Pathfinders from time to time, but also our Chevy truck. So we went down to a local Chevy dealer. Mm-hmm. Let's see what they have to say.
Let's see.
We're here at the local Chevy dealer, and we're here with service manager Craig Pierce. Craig, we used to change the oil every 3,500 to 4 months. What are the policies today with Chevy?
Rick, the policies today on the Chevrolets are the vehicle will actually tell you when to bring it in and change the oil. When it gets down to about 20% or less, that's when you should call us in, either make an appointment, bring it in, and we'll do an oil change, a tire rotation, and a multi-point vehicle inspection. We check the tires, the brakes, belts, fluids, filters. That way, when you leave, the vehicle is actually safe to drive.
All the guys are certified technicians in the back, but it's not always convenient to drop off your car. So if you have to wait, what do we have to offer when it comes to that?
Well, our waiting room is, to date, it has Wi-Fi. So if you need to come in and do a little homework, if you want to come in and have some coffee and donuts, we have all the amenities. Just come in and wait for it, or you can make an appointment and just leave it.
Well, as Craig said, servicing your car is just as important as making sure that your boat is up to date as well. So guys, if you have some service needs, make sure you contact your local Chevy dealer. You know, even though it's a Chevy, there's still maintenance to be done. So guys,
always
contact your local Chevy dealer, right, Bree?
Chevys are great. Wait, now entering the Derringer Zone with Captain Tommy Derringer. Stand by for a Baitacular report. Tommy?
Hey guys, you know, we've got all kinds of different bait here in the strike zone northeast region, and especially right now. You know, our year-round staples for inshore live bait are going to be shrimp and mud minnows. And just about all our inshore game fish eat one or the other or both of those baits. A quarter-ounce jig head with a live shrimp or mud minnow is going to be the go-to for redfish, trout, and flounder for just about all our inshore anglers in my region, no matter what time of year it is. Now, there's so many different baits to talk about offshore, but right now, frozen sardines or cigar minnows are getting a lot of use on the bottom for all kinds of snapper and other bottom fish. Now, this time of year and through all the warmer months, there are two other baits that we tend to fish with more in my region than any others, both inshore and offshore, and that's mullet and menhaden, better known as pogies in my region. You know, the finger mullet are everywhere right now inshore, and all our inshore species are fired up to eat those mullet. The go-to rig for finger mullet is going to be a fish finder rig with just enough weight to hold that mullet on the bottom. Now, cut mullet is also a great bait for redfish through the whole summer. Sometimes there's nothing better than a stinky old piece of cut mullet next to your favorite oyster bar. The redfish can't seem to pass it up this time of year. Now, our water is still murky during the warmer months that any bait with a good scent, like cut bait, is going to work really well. Now, the other abundant bait fish is the pogie, and right now there are a ton of pogie pods or schools along the beach. The tarpon, sharks, and kingfish will all be in those pods all summer long, eating their fill of those pogies. Now, they're really a versatile bait. You can fish them on the bottom, up top, you control them. They make for some awesome cut bait, both inshore and offshore. And just about everything is gonna eat them. And if you're looking to bend a rod, you can just about always find something big around those pokey pods. And speaking of something big, I got a picture here of my client, Jeff Parsons, with a nice tarpon he caught with me recently, using a live three-line pokey around a big bait pod right along the beach.
Wow, that's a good picture there, Tommy. Let's stay inshore. What else you got, bud?
Well, you know, the redfish bite has been pretty good this week on the low tide, both in the creeks and along the intercoastal waterway, pretty much throughout the entire region. Now, that low tide is going to be around midday this weekend, and with the air temperatures reaching into the 90s this week, you're probably going to want to get up early and get on that high tide topwater bite. Now, I spoke with Captain Chris Herrera from PalmCoastFishing.com, and he tells me that the early morning glassy conditions have made it just about perfect for tossing a skitterwalk. Now, he's been fishing around the Pellissier Flat on the high tide stage, and those glassy conditions at first light have made it easy to spot the schools of really nervous mullet. That's where you want to be casting your plug. Now, Chris tells me that the reds are feeding on the surface really early on those mullet, but once the sun comes up and you can feel the heat a little bit, it's probably time to go to a subsurface plug or some kind of live bait. Now, he's also been having some banner days in some of the smaller creeks down in the Palm Coast area on low tide, tossing live shrimp on a jig head into the deeper creek hole. I got a photo here that Captain Chris sent me of Eric Shun from Palm Coast with a nice upper slot redfish with a face full of skitterwalk plug. Now, moving offshore, the mangrove snapper bite has been wide open this week. And I spoke with Captain Jeffrey Crabtree from RightSpotCharters.com. He tells me they've been catching some big mangoes out there this week. He's been fishing the natural bottom and ledges from about 110 to 130 feet. And Jeff tells me that you will definitely see your hummingbird sonar light up with those mangroves when you find the right structure. Now, he's chumming with chunk frozen sardines or cigar minnows and getting those snapper to come right up to the surface. Captain Jeff says one big key is get anchored up correctly, as you really want that chum to be going down current to the fish. Now, once those fish are up top, you can drift back a chunk of bait on a small one-off BMC circle hook with about 10 to 15 foot of 30-pound fluorocarbon. Jeff says remember to be slow and steady with that chum, because if you overdo it, they're probably going to stop chewing. Those mangroves are running anywhere from about 5 to 10 pounds. And I got a picture here of Lee Davis with an 11-pound mangrove he caught with Captain Jeffrey a couple of days ago. Now, also offshore, you know, the kingfish season is on right now. And I spoke with Captain Steven Zapanek from LuckyBirdCharters.com. And he tells me the nearshore kingfish bite out of St. Augustine is really good right now. He's trolling pogies and ribbon fish anywhere from about 5 to 10 miles out. He says that the bigger kingfish are going to come off the natural bottom, especially those areas holding a lot of bait. Now, he says a lot of times that really big kingfish is going to like a ribbon fish trolled way, way back in the shotgun. Now, Captain Steven also says there are quite a few smaller kings on all the nearshore wrecks right now. Now, with the kingfish tournament season about to start, sounds like those guys are going to have some fun fish to play with out there.
All right, great report from the Strike Zone Northeast region. We're going to take a look at the hot spots from Captain Tommy's region. Inshore tarpon and sharks behind the shrimp boats and the pogie pods along the beaches and in the inlets. Also be on the lookout for some of those big bonita in the same areas. And then offshore, mangrove snapper in the 21 fathom depth, chum and chunk cigar minnows or sardines, and get them to come to the top and then drift your chunks back.
All right, guys and gals in the East region, I hope your ears are perked because bait is plentiful right now. And Mike Holiday says you can sleep late if you use bait, and I like the sound of that.
That's been my mantra for a long time, guys. You know I like to load the wells. Well, you know, in my region, the most popular baits for inshore and offshore fishing are the herring species. Threadfin herring, Spanish sardines, and scaled sardines, which they also call pilchards. You can catch them in a cast net if they're close to shore, or you can use a sabiki rig. And I really like that R&R sabiki rig. It's got 8 hooks, 4 green, 4 red, and fluorocarbon lines. So when the sardines are picky, really catches them well, better than some of the other rigs. Some of the more consistent areas to catch those baits are off the Juneau and Lake Worth piers, the Church Rubble north of Jupiter, Bull Shark Barge, the 14 buoy, the 10A buoy, and the Vero Cove. You also catch goggle eyes, cigar minnows, speedos, and blue runners in those same areas. Now, inshore, you can always use a cast net to catch mullet around the sandbars or near the inlets or along the shoreline. And you can catch pinfish or sand perch by hanging a chum bag on the grass flats and using pieces of squid on a number 10 Aberdeen hook. You can also use a pinfish trap, bait it with either crab or a box of squid. You can do really well catching bait that way. If you like crabs for bait, You know, we get a lot of crabs this time of year going out the inlet on the outgoing tides. You need to just basically find the grass line, figure out where the grass is gathered along the tide line, and get a dip net and dip up the crabs with that long-handled dip net. And if you like to surf fish, this is also a good time of year to take a sand flea rake out to the beach, rake up some sand fleas and either use them live, or you can blanch them in hot or boiling water for 8 seconds and freeze them to use for later dates. So a lot of bait options in my region.
All right, what else you got for us, Mike? Let's go inshore.
You know, this week we saw the first big push of migrating tarpon along the beach. And the fish are traveling in 12 to 20 feet of water. The schools are anywhere from like 20 to 100, 150 fish. You want to start your day by looking for those fish that are laid up, you know, around the Blowing Rocks area, around Peck's Lake, around the Vero Cove, or even on the north side of pretty much any inlet in my region. And then as the day goes on, look for the moving schools that are traveling north along the beach. When you find those fish, get ahead of the school, shut down, approach them on your trolling motor or drift into them. You gotta approach them quietly or they won't bite. Pitch out a live crab, a thread fin, a sardine, or a pilchard. And you can also throw bright colored flies on the real bright days and have really good results on them. The average tarpon in my region right now is 70 to 100 pounds. And then moving offshore, there's been a really early blackfin tuna bite. It's sort of been early morning, late afternoon, from Boynton Inlet all the way up to Hope Sound. The majority of fish are either spread out, you know, just arbitrarily in 240 to 360 feet of water, or they're holding on the deeper wrecks. A lot of the fish are coming on live baits, either by guys that are drifting and hanging them out on kites or drifting and putting them out behind the boat, or slow trolling those live baits. And you can also live chum with small pilchards. You can chum with small sardines, and even glass minnows will bring those fish close to the boat. Just expect to deal with a lot of bonitas. The average blackfin right now is 12 to 20 pounds, but there's been a good number of fish caught this week that weighed well over 30 pounds. So you need to gear up a little bit. 30-pound tackle, 25-pound fluorocarbon leader, and a 3.0 to 4.0 circle hook. And just to give you an idea of some of those big tanks out there, I got a photo. That's Tommy Neal to Stewart. He caught that 35-pound blackfin off Hope Sound. That fish ate a live pilchard. So, you know, some big blackfins out there right now.
All right, what else you got for us, Mike?
Well, the dolphin bite's been up and down all week, but when it's good, man, it's really good. There's been a lot of weed lines out there, but only a handful of the weeds are holding dolphins. So, you know, it's kind of difficult to tell where the fish. The best bites this week are coming in 100 to 140 feet of water from Jensen Beach to Fort Pierce. You want to start by covering water until you find fish, then work that depth that you find the fish in. It seems like every day the fish are in a certain depth more so than just on the weeds. You can troll ballyhoo with a pink or orange skirt or a blue and white skirt. You can do that to cover water and help avoid the weeds a little bit. And be sure anytime you hook a fish, keep it in the water for any of the schoolies that will show up and have pitch rods ready to throw to them. Average dolphin's been 8 to 15 pounds with a pretty decent number of fish in the 20 to 30 pound range this week.
All right, just like we always do every week, we need to know some bass info. I know you got some good stuff from Dean Hardiman. Tell me about it.
I do. I was talking, you know, despite the summer heat, the bass fishing's been steady on the Stick Marsh Farm 13 Reservoir in Fellsmere. I was talking to Dean Hardiman. He was telling me he's averaging 25 bites a morning. He's throwing lipless crankbaits or shallow running square bill crankbaits. He's working the drop-off. Find the drop-off, you find the fish right now. On the days where the wind's blowing, particularly in the afternoon, you know, during the heat when there's a lot of wind going, the afternoon frog bite has been very good, throwing dark-colored frogs way up into the grass and then pausing the baits over the potholes as you reel them out. He said if you got live shiners, they've been working well when you fish the edges of the grass or anywhere there's moving water around the pump houses or anywhere you can find, you know, water being moved from one area to the other. Average bass has been 2 to 6 pounds with the occasional 8-pound fish in the mix. And Dean sent me a photo. That's Jerry Shelton of Tulsa, Oklahoma. He was fishing with Dean this week. He caught that 6-pound bass out of the Stick Marsh fishing a lipless crankbait.
All right, great report from the Decks and Docks East region. Mike, we're going to go ahead and take a look at the hot spots from the Decks and Docks East region. Inshore, catch and release snook at Jupiter Inlet, live croakers, sardines, sand perch on the incoming tide, and then offshore, groupers off Fort Pierce in 90 to 120 feet of water, live pinfish, thread fins, or grunt plugs in 60 to 80 pound tackles.
Did you hear about the great white shark in Jupiter they found this weekend?
No, ma'am.
I did. It's crazy. Shark Week's almost here. Okay, when we return, we're escaping to the Keys region and then seeing what new products Mr. Farrell has for us, right, Dave?
It's my imitation of Bree.
Of Jaws.
Bree talking.
Bye-bye. Or me. That works. Okay, you won't want to miss this. We'll be right back.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by the Florida Keys and Key West. Come as you are. Hookup Lures, premium lures for serious anglers. FWC, the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. La Jolla Resort, a place for family and fishermen. Navionics, we start where the road ends. Maverick Boat Company, celebrating 30 years of leadership in innovation, conservation, and stability. And First National Bank, your first choice for better banking.
It's 200 streamlined horsepower of Yamaha forward thinking. The all-new F200 inline four-stroke. Whether you're an offshore angler, pontoon cruiser, bay boater, or walleye hunter, the responsive and fuel-efficient F200 combines amazing power and versatility in one incredibly compact and lightweight package. The all-new F200. Legendary Yamaha reliability and the freedom of forward thinking.
You know there's more to it than luck. There's fishing the right bait, the water temperature, the wind, the season, and then there's the boat. We'll put it simply, the boat matters. To own a Contender is to own the best sport fishing boat on the market, period. Contender offers the most comprehensive model range with bigger, faster, and more fuel-efficient boats than the competition. There's only one choice for serious anglers. Contender Boats. Performance through innovation.
Fishermen are created equal. Some just use better fishing line.
Well, welcome back to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. We're over here at the CCA workbench, Dave, talking about new products.
We got stuff to look at.
Tell me about
this. We're
going
to start with the Rapala folding fillet board.
I saw that,
yeah,
imitating
nice.
Brie.
Yep, very nice. This is it's made out of a USDA, FDA approved food grade plastic. So, you know, it doesn't keep bacteria on it for long periods of time. It rinses off real clean. It folds down to 16 inch square, you know, so you can take it on the boat and take it around with you, and folds out to obviously 32 inches, you know.
Very practical.
Nice big, you know, you can fillet just about any size fish on there that you want to. And it's also good for, you know, you don't have to just bring it on the boat. It's good for if you want to go camping, or, you know, in the kitchen even. If you have another, you want to have another cutting board in the kitchen, it's awesome to have.
It works.
You know, a cutting board is always great to have. So, you know, get a Rapala folding fillet board.
Very practical. Somebody was thinking at
nice.
Rapala.
Hey, why not?
Exactly.
Time somebody should start doing something.
Like
these are the new Bass Assassin color, and you said it's been kicking butt.
It has
the sun gill.
The sun gill. The thing that I have found in the plastic world, Dave, is there's a lot of plastics out there and a lot of different colors.
Yep.
But only a few colors work in all the different watercolor tints.
And your conditions, probably.
And conditions. That's one of the things that I like about this new sun gill. Whether it's clear water, whether it's a tannic stain water, it's got the clear glitter, it's got some black glitter in there, it's got a real defined lateral line like you would see in some baits.
Like on a fish,
and
yeah.
It works. This is obviously the Bass Assassin
Dye Dapper
in 5-inch, but you can get this color in all the different products that they make.
Brand new color.
Good job, Bass Assassin.
Sungill, it's the Sungill.
Yep.
This is a new Williamson lure. These are the Surface Pros. You know, it's a top water plug, very versatile. You can do a lot of different things with that. You know, you can walk the dog with it, or you can just rip it and let it hang, you know, slash bait, you know, and it's just a really good top water plug. It's got those inline hooks that are all the rage now. A lot of the guys are really preferring these inlines because when they, you know, when they move along, they go back against the body, and they don't, you know, supposedly they're a better hookup ratio and whatnot. So
Well, I'll tell you
what.
Big
oval eyes on those things, so yeah. Real heavy duty, so you can fish for pelagic fish with it. You don't have to worry about pulling that thing apart. There's a lot of plugs these days that you can pull apart, but not the
Williamses. They ain't pulling this apart.
No, those things are made.
And I bet we can go catch a big snook on this, too.
Exactly. It'll work for both of them.
Really work.
Big oval springs on there, and it's weighted perfectly to cast. I mean, it's got a really good weight system, and it'll cast a long way. Now, these next lures here are victory lures. These are some vertical jigs, and our buddy Kwanzaa, you know, the guy who does all the kayaking, he sent me this guy's information and said, yeah, you got to check out these victory lures. And they're all vertical jigging lures. And, you know, he makes them from 40 grams up to 180 grams, which is like, I don't know, 1.5 ounces up to almost 9 ounces. And if you like to fish for, you know, any pelagic species, you know, tunas, wahoo, dolphins, groupers, any one of these vertical jigs would do the job. You know, they use a big mustad hook, a 200-pound fiber rigging on here, so you're not going to pull them apart again. And just a really good little doodad right there.
Mm-hmm.
He's got also this cotton candy one. This is the brand new one. The blue, what is this thing called? The blue Speedo. Blue Speedo is another one. And they've had these darts for a long time. He's been making the darts, but the Speedos
I got a red Speedo I wear.
I bet you do. I bet you that's very attractive. But, you know, check out these victory lures. A guy really, you know, makes them here in Florida, so we need to help him out. His name's Jesse Acosta.
All right. Good job, Dave.
He's a good fella. Makes good stuff.
Bree, speaking of a Speedo, does your man Joe wear one of those from time to time?
Heck no, of course he doesn't. All right. I'm sure Captain Randy Tao has the key to getting that bite down there in paradise, so listen up.
Hey, good evening, fish fans. I'm just going to pretend I didn't hear that.
You didn't.
Bait in my region is really a popular thing. Now, backcountry is one scenario, offshore is another. If you're going to go in the backcountry, let's say, and you want to catch bait, primary bait you're going to target is going to be pinfish, mullet, or pilchards. And a lot of times, if you're in a hurry, you're going to throw your cast net on your pilchards or your mullet and keep on going. It's a quick way to get bait. Not the best bait that'll last you all day, but certainly it's a quick fix if you're going to go fishing and use it. Throwing the cast net works great. Otherwise, you want to anchor down or stake the boat out, put a chum bag, and I like the R&R sabikis to catch my bait with. A number 6 works really well for the pinfish and the pilchards in the backcountry. Now you're rod and reeling your bait, so it takes a little more time, and you're going to use a dehooker to take your bait off of the sabiki rig, and you're never going to touch your bait, going to drop it right in the live well, and you're going to have quality bait throughout the day. Now, if you're on the Atlantic and you're going to go fishing, depending on the species you're going to go after, we've got pilchards, we've got ballyhoos, speedos, blue runners, goggle eyes, thread fins. There's a whole assortment of bait that we catch offshore to do our fishing. Now, same method applies. If you're in a hurry, you throw your cast net. If you're trying to preserve your bait and have a better bait throughout the day, or a lot of guys will pin up their bait. They'll catch bait for tournaments, sometimes months in advance, and they handle this bait with white gloves. They never let them hit the deck. They never touch them. Drop them in the live well with the D-hooker. They're very meticulous about how they take care of their bait, and that might be key to some of these guys' success in the tournaments, because you see the top guys most always in the tournaments, and that's what they do. So you're gonna anchor down on the ocean just like you would in the backcountry. You're going to be patient, you're going to jig up your bait, and you're going to have good lasting bait throughout the day. That's how we do it here. We also have had some good bone fishing. You know, you're going to hear me talk more and more about the bone fishing from around here in the Upper Keys down through the Lower Keys. More guys are going after the bonefish right now because there's some around. We had a real drought for the last 5 or 6 years where they were just not around, and they're starting to come back, which is great news, and these guys are finding them. Some days some big ones, some days medium-sized, 6-pounders, 7-pounders, but nonetheless, guys are getting their shots. One guy in particular does it a lot. Captain Dave Dankard fishes out of the Lorelei. He goes bone fishing on a regular basis. For some reason, he likes these things, and he goes after them, and he has success. But he knows it's critical to, with your timing, with the tide and the conditions, when to go and where to look. That's what makes these guys as good as they are, is they know that information, and they can go up in the right place at the right time. Offshore right now, blackfin tunas. June is a great month for tunas. They're on the offshore humps from Alamorada down to Marathon, and they're also out in the middle. You'll be driving along looking for dolphin. Next thing you know, you'll see a big flock of birds. Chances are those are migrating tunas traveling, and you can get in front of the birds and go through them just like you would on the humps with the tunas, and you can catch some real nice blackfins on the troll. Or if you have live bait like pilchards, you're going to need a bunch of them. You can live bait them. You're going to get up in front of the school, pitch out some live baits, and let the fish come to you. And that same scenario applies on the humps, and that's how a lot of these guys will catch these 25 and 30-pound blackfin tunas this time of year, is live bait late in the day or early in the morning, just after sunrise. It's prime time. So that's what a lot of the guys do in conjunction with dolphin fishing. They'll go looking for the tunas as well. Now, moving inshore to the reef, you know, I love yellowtails. I love bottom fishing. This week, we've had some great bottom fishing on the edge of the reef. Not a good condition, but the fish have been there. They've been on the bigger size, and the key to that is patience. We had a day where we put two lines in, and we could literally see the fish start to move back as we put the pressure on them. We kept one line in the water. We consistently caught our yellowtails 60 to 80 feet of water. Chum a lot and just be patient. That's the key that I can tell you. If you want successful yellowtailing right now, that's what you got to do.
All right, great report, Randy. I'm going to go ahead and take a look at the Los Hoyas hotspots from the Florida Keys region. Captain Randy says that inshore, he's going to get those bonefish that Dave Dinkert's been catching, look on the rising tide on the ocean side, then work towards the backcountry as the tide gets higher. Moving as water is certainly going to be key. And then offshore, blackfin tuna troll the offshore humps with dark feathers early and late in the day, and look for the large flocks of birds moving fast in 400 to 800 feet of water.
And don't touch that bait. Be true to your bait, or they will be false to you and the fish.
Oh,
so sweet.
Whatever.
Now it's time to tell you about some tournaments in the Florida Keys. This weekend's Ladies Dolphin Tournament is to be based from the Florida Keys Elks Lodge in Tavernier. Cash and merchandise prizes will be awarded to the top 10 teams and determined by the combined weights of three dolphin catches. Founded by baseball great and avid fly fisherman Ted Williams, the Gold Cup Tarpon Tournament is set for Monday through the 19th in Isla Mirada and is limited to 25 anglers. You can fish with some of your favorite former Hurricane sports stars at the University of Miami Sports Hall of Fame Celebrity Dolphin Tournament. That's almost as long as our title, Rick. June 26th to the 27th in Isla Mirada. Among several charities, proceeds benefit Habitat for Humanity of the Upper Keys and the UM Sports Hall of Fame. The Isla Mirada Dolphin Tournament is set for July 10th through the 12th and features $15,000 in cash and prizes. The event is staged by the Isla Mirada Charter Boat Association. And now let's hear from our trusty correspondent, as always in the Florida Keys, Andy Newman.
It has a new sponsor, but the tournament is still one of the premier angling contests in the Florida Keys. We're talking about the Bacardi Oakhart Key West Marlin Tournament. It's set for July 22nd to the 25th. Now, as always, this release-oriented tournament takes place during the annual Hemingway Days Festival. There's a guaranteed $50,000 cash prize, including $25,000 to the top winner. Teams can also enter one fish per day, including a tuna, wahoo, or release sailfish to add to their points total. There's more information at keywestmarlin.com, and for more details on other tournaments in the Florida Keys, go to flakeys.com. Back to you in the studio.
Fantastic, Andy. When we return on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, we're idling over to the Central East and Northwest region, so stay hooked.
The Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Rapala. Catch the latest at rapala.com. Startron. Cures and prevents ethanol fuel problems. Yeti Coolers. Built for the wild. CCA Florida. The voice of recreational anglers for over 30 years. Strike Zone Fishing. Guy Harvey. Marine wildlife artist and conservationist. And Sea Sucker. Vacuum mounting systems.
Serious fishermen demand quality equipment on their boats and on shore. That's why Florida boaters have trusted Decks and Docks for over 20 years for dock lumber, hardware, and accessories. Tough products that stand up to the roughest environments and elegance to please the most discerning homeowner tastes. Decks and Docks, supplying waterfront customers with lumber, decking, and seawall, with 10 locations across Florida.
Which car company has the most 2015 models with a 5-star overall vehicle score for safety?
Ranking from top to bottom.
I associate the safety with the luxury vehicles.
Probably Japanese cars.
I think Toyota.
The final answer, Chevy.
Yeah, this is what you want for your family.
They thought about me.
Safety is everything.
Find your Chevy bonus tag, find your deal, like $2,500 total cash allowance on select cruise vehicles in stock.
Find new roads at your local Chevy dealer.
Power Pole's headquarters, and today's Power Pole tip of the week is certainly about the great finishes that you get on all your power poles. Now let's talk a little bit about the components. Now the components consist of great bushings that are built into each and every power pole. It comes with stainless and brass hardware, a 2 to 5 year warranty depending on the model that you buy. Now the spike has a lifetime unconditional warranty, so even if you make a mistake and you drag it down the road by accident, Power Pole will replace it for you. Now when it comes to the tech support, you have the Sea Monster app that you can use to diagnose your problem, or you can actually go on their website and look at one of 1,500 dealers and find out how they can help you as well. But the other thing you can do is you can certainly call Power Pole and talk to a technician anytime that you want. That's today's Power Pole tip of the week. It's about the great service that you get with Power Pole. You know, service support, whether it's Yamaha, whether it's Pathfinder, certainly Power Pole or Chevy, is everything.
Mm-hmm. Muy importante.
Yes,
right?
Exactly.
Hey, Captain Jim, I hope the bait's plentiful up there. So we have a great weekend of fishing coming up in the Central East region, and let the fish gods be with us.
Well, let's hope so, Bree. And the bait is starting to come back. It's been a little scarce, but it is coming back as of later part of this week. And, you know, it doesn't matter if you're chasing inshore or offshore fish. Bait is a game changer most of the time if your intended quarry won't hit your favorite lucky lure. So, you know what? It doesn't matter if you're fishing inshore in the lagoons where we use pigfish, fingerling mullet, pinfish, shrimp, or cut bait like ladyfish. The speckled trout, black drum, flounder, and redfish will obviously respond better some days to those baits than they will to those artificials. Now, when we're out along the beach, we like to get things like croakers, menhaden, which are pogies, for those of you that may not be from the Central East region, pilchards, and of course the tarpon, snook, jacks, all of those offshore species really like to eat those particular baits. And then a little farther offshore, if you're not cast netting stuff in the surf, you get sabiki. And we get sardines, blue runners, thread fins, cigar minnows, and a variety of other bait fish. And those are generally good for your dolphin and your grouper and your amberjack and other, you know, species that we get offshore. Now, right now, if you're looking for bait fish, pigfish and pinfish seem to be in the sandy potholes and the deeper grass flats. Mullet are usually found around the causeways and spoil islands. And in the near shore waters, croakers especially, and also the menhaden, can be found right around the surf break or just outside the surf break on most days. Buoys and wrecks, that's the best place if you're going to find blue runners or cigar minnows or thread fins. And you know what? It doesn't really matter. As long as you're using one of these species, you're going to be able to get something whenever you're going offshore. Now, the main thing you want to think about is with your live baits is you want to keep the bait lively, and you do this by not overcrowding the baits in your bait well or in your bait bucket, because frisky baits are much more effective than lethargic baits, and so it's really important to keep them healthy. Now, our inshore species this week is one of those species that we mention all the time, but this week we're having a good run of them, and that's the speckled trout. Rapalus, skitterwalk bugs, storm chug bugs, anything that looks like a mullet, fished around a mullet pot is a great thing. Also, sea shad, like the saltwater assassin sea shad, that 4-inch model in particular, under an assassin quick cork is a great way to find fish
up into the lower 20-inch range when you're fishing in the Indian, Banana Rivers, and Mesquite Lagoon, especially if you're fishing those deeper flats. We have a lot of slot-sized trout gathering around docks and mangroves in the south part of the region right now. Look for those mangroves that overhang the water where the trout can run out and ambush glass minnows and finger mullet as they pass by. And then swinging offshore, I tell you what, the House of Pain is out there, and if you're fishing in the 160 to 250-foot depths, you have got a shot at them. And, of course, I'm talking about amberjack. Now, some places you're going to have to deal with a little bit of heavy current, especially if you're outside of the 200-foot mark. But there's enough fish within the 160 to 200-foot range. You should not have a problem finding them. Live pinfish, grunts, and sardines seem to be working real good. And, of course, you can always cast nets and pogies and take them out there with you. And for the guys that like to do the artificial fishing, those Williamson vertical jigs can get you into one of those reef donkeys as long as you're diligent with it, especially if you're fishing in the early morning to mid-morning time frames. And most of our amberjack right now, Rick, are running about 30 to 50 pounds, but you know what? We've got some larger ones. And Captain Tyler Vollmer on the Fired Up Charters has a great shot of one that he got recently. He's been putting his clients on some pretty healthy fish, as you can see by this picture. But that amberjack he's holding is said to weigh just right at 100 or just over 100 pounds. That thing hit a pinfish in 190 feet of water.
So, Jim, wow. If you have that calm day, I'll pay you an extra 200 to take Bree out there and put her on those amberjacks just to give her the pain that she's been inflicting on me and Dave tonight.
Hey, if you can't take it, get out of the kitchen.
I'll tell you what, Rick, we may have some big beach donkeys for her, and I think that if she gets one of those 25 or 30-pound jacks up, those crevalles, I'm not sure if she's going to want one of those 100-pound amberjacks.
Well, let's test her. I think we should.
Let's do that, okay. Well, we've got sharks as well in the Central East region this weekend. We've had some dirty water, and we've had a little bit of a swell, and it's made those sharks really aggressive. They're hitting your baits. They're hitting your weights in some cases. The other day, I swear, I just should have put a lead egg sinker on my hook because I think I could have got more bites than the bait I was using. But, you know, that's the way it is some days. We've got a lot of fine tooth and black tips in there right now. You're going to get those in along the beach and on the nearshore reefs. And we've also got bulls, spinners, black tips, and hammerheads that are fishing, we're catching them on chunks and live fish as we're fishing out over those reefs and wrecks that are a little bit deeper in that 80 to about 160-foot depth. Most of our sharks are about 20 to 80 pounds, but we have some of those bull sharks and hammerheads that are running up over 200. So, Bree, you better get ready because we're going to try and see if we can put you on something that's going to pull as hard as you've been giving them a hard time tonight.
I'm ready. I've been in the gym.
I love it. All right, we're going to go ahead and take a look at the hookup lure hotspots from the Central East region. And sure, speckled trout in the Indian River north of Sebastian use live croakers or pilchards near the spoil islands and mangrove-covered shorelines. And then offshore, amberjacks on the structure in 160 to 200 feet of water use live baits on a fish finder rig with a 8-0 or 9-0 size VMC circle hook.
Mama. I'm not talking to you.
I know. It's actually a perfect world.
Great.
Now.
I know this captain is all about that bait, no trouble, from the Northwest region. And that captain's Jeff Hageman, of course.
All about that bait.
Heck yeah. No trouble.
Yep, we've got lots of it. We use a lot of it in my region, from shrimp, pinfish, pigfish, gale sardines, redfin herring, Spanish sardines, mullet are going to be the most common. Some of them you can buy in your local bait shop. Some of them you got to go out and throw a cast net for. It's usually the way most of us start our day, getting out there, chumming. Everybody's got their own little recipes for chum. They catch sardines on the flat. Just jack mackerel and a little leaf bread or jack mackerel and some dry fish chum works pretty good. Coming over the flats, you can catch them. You can catch them under bridges, piers. VPN works is another great, effective way to use them. Pinfish traps, if you can't throw a cast net, not feel this sticky rod, is a great way to get bait, or a great way if you're going to go out first thing in the morning and you're going grouper fishing, you can put some pinfish traps out the night before. You're allowed to have a few of those out and catch pinfish, pigfish, and have those ready for you when you guys get out there and pick up your traps on the way out to your favorite grouper spot. So that's another great way to do it. Also, crabs right now, we're using a lot of crabs. The outgoing tides right now on these new and full moons and summer months, got in the passes and in Egmont Channel and on the little passes all throughout our coast right now and catch these pass crabs coming out. They're good for cobia, tarpon, and permit. And that's another great bait out there we've got. But moving inshore,
We've got a lot of good snook fishing right now in the lower part of my region. It's going to get better and better. This next moon coming up, you should see a lot of spawn balls, which is a snook real tight together on one female and moving out passes. And these fish are going to all be pushing towards the passes to spawn this next month, on this next moon. So be ready for that. And along the beaches and the Sabash Channel is where they're going to be staging up. Pinfish, sardines, free-lined, and big fish also free-lined, or just a little bit of weight to hold it down in the current if you're fishing in the path, anywhere from 25 to 40 pound fluorocarbon leader. And I've got a photo of Dave Perdue here with his son with a nice little West Coast snook.
All right, what else you got
so
for
cute.
Us, man? That's
oh
a cool
gosh.
Picture.
He's
Look
like,
at that little
heck?
Man.
What the heck is that?
That little Brody, he's new to fishing, but he's going to be a good fisherman. That's coming up. He's going to be a good fisherman.
That's the face I made the first time I met Rick. Just kidding.
Come on, let's go inshore. I'm losing control
let's go
here.
Offshore.
Yeah, whatever.
Red grouper, 150 feet to 120 feet of water throughout the region right now. It seems to be on fire. Anywhere you got that flat rock, that Swiss cheese bottom in my region, it seemed to have tons of red grouper in that depth right now. Pinfish, cut squid on a standard bottom rig. You can get out there. If the current's not too bad and the wind's not too bad, you can literally set up on that rock and just drift over top of it, put some weights down, put a little bit heavier egg sinker on, and just drift over that bottom, and you can catch plenty of red grouper right now. They seem to be everywhere. And also offshore, Captain Henry Conover of Hook 'em Harry Charters, Jimbo was just talking about this a second ago. We got AJ fishing anywhere right now in 75 to 150 feet of water over our major structure right now and springs. So either the major structure or springs is where they're going to be. You want to look for them suspended on your bottom machine. Blue runners, pinfish, butterfly jigs, diamond jigs all work well. AJ's like fast-moving baits, so the livelier the better. And if you're working those butterfly jigs or those diamond jigs, move it as fast as you can and then stop it and then rip it again and then stop it. They usually pull off a good bite.
All right, great report from the Yeti Northwest region. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the Drummond Community Bank hotspots. Inshore, snook around the beaches and passes, use pinfish or sardines on the outgoing tide. And then offshore, corberitas, which is basically a true black grouper in 130 to 180 foot of rock piles and ledges, use pinfish and pigfish for bait.
I didn't know that. Thank you, Rick.
Oh, you're welcome.
Very sweet of you. Okay, don't throw that cast net just yet. We still have our Coastal Conservation Minute Tip and the Panhandle region to visit when we return on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report.
Where are you going, Bree?
Running from you.
Aggravating
the Chevy
me.
Florida Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Chevrolet, find new roads. Yamaha, reliability starts here. Suffix, the world's most hardcore fishing line. The IGFA, conservation through education. Get your hands wet. Florida Outdoor Experience. Captain Harry's Fishing Supply Company. And there's no stopping Okuma.
Introducing Helmmaster, Yamaha's first fully integrated digital boat control system. With Helmmaster, you can start your outboards with a swipe of a paw and control them with a single lever. Outboard trim and steering friction adjust automatically as you accelerate and decelerate. Adjust engine speed with the touch of a button. The Helmmaster joystick provides the means to navigate and dock precisely with confidence and ease. Take control of your next vessel with Helmmaster at your command.
Introducing the Yeti Hopper. Leak-proof, ice for days, tough as nails. Built to go the extra mile, and then some.
Remember the glory days of gasoline? It's just not made the same anymore.
Kick your gas into gear with StarTron. Pump up the performance in all of your engines. Cure the problems of ethanol with the power of enzymes. And maximize your mileage every time you drive. Kickstart your engines with StarTron.
Can a truck change how people feel about a guy? We talk to real people, not actors.
we showed them two pictures of the same guy in the same location. The only difference, the vehicle behind him.
The guy with the truck would definitely have like a German Shepherd dog. I mean, come on.
Like a tarantula.
A rattlesnake.
What kind of pet would this guy have?
Maybe like some birds.
You know you want a truck. The all-new Chevy Colorado. Motor Trend's 2015 Truck of the Year.
Today's Coast to Cool Place and Moment certainly has to be about shocking here in the Stick Marsh. Now, the thing that was so cool to me is I had heard about how they shock certain areas in certain ponds, but to actually get on the boat with Bob Eisenhower and his assistant was awesome. And the reason why is because I fully got to understand how the whole program works, but more importantly, who can say that they actually put their hands on a 10.5-pound fish with the shocking method? Now, the way that thing works is, I assure you, it doesn't hurt any of the fish. We go along with the net and we're scooping up the fish that have actually been stunned by the electricity going through the water, and they put them in a live well. After putting them in the live well, they let them come back to where they're not shocked anymore. They're in there swimming around with the aeration going on, and then they measure each one of those fish. And that's how a lot of the biologists are able to come up with the healthiness of the lake. Certainly, if the fish are skinny per so many inches, then they might have to adjust the way they manage that place. Versus if they're too fat, then there's really no problem with that. But realistically, it was one of the coolest things that I have ever done. And to be able to actually put my hands on a 10.5-pounder because of that method really reassured me in what the FWC is doing in managing a lot of these great lakes. You know, Bree, right after we got off the boat and we went back to doing the Sportsman's Adventure episode, they went down the shoreline another 100 yards and got another 1025. That fish that wow. I saw was 1056. Just so cool, and
that
it's so
cool.
Neat. As fishermen, you know, you cast and cast and cast, and you wonder if where you're fishing, there's fish. This is a proven method that the lakes and the systems are very healthy.
That's so cool.
It is.
I want to do it.
Okay.
All right, last but not least is Captain Patanine from the Panhandle region, where catching bait was literally the easiest place I have ever caught bait at. Amen to that, Pat.
Yeah, I'll tell you what.
it was crazy.
Every morning in the summertime, all our inlets are definitely bait factories.
That's nice.
And to catch your own bait in the Panhandle, just invest in a cast net or pick up some sabiki rigs. A 10-foot net with 3/8 inch mesh is great for catching pogies, larger pilchards, finger mullets, and pinfish. Use a 1/4 inch mesh if you want to catch the smaller pilchards and pogies in a 1 to 3 inch range. They're great for chumming or for bay fish and for speckled trout and redfish. You're going to find your pogies throughout the Apalachicola Bay system and also in the upper areas of the remaining bays, basically where there's any freshwater inflow going on. In our bay, Alapaw Bayou, Hogtown Bayou, and also on the far eastern end by Chattahoochee River is great for catching the pogies. If you want to catch your own gulf baits, the incoming tide every morning outside our passes are great for herring, cigar minnows, hardtail, use a sabiki rig, and then mark your fish on the bottom machine or see them flipping on the surface, drop your sabiki rig, and then once you get one bite, just steadily wind them in. You want to make sure you stay tight with the sabiki, otherwise you're going to get a rodeo rig. And then try to load up all those hooks. And it's when you get one on, just stay tight, and you're going to fill up those remaining hooks. And then finally, if you don't want to catch your bait, all of our inlets have live bait guys working there every morning, weather permitting. You can roll up to them, trade some greenbacks for some minnows, you know, $20, $30 scoop. You're going to get all you want for the day. But make sure you call them on a VHF radio or on the cell phone, or have them wave you in before you just come rolling up on them, because they may be about to throw that cast net.
All right, then stay inshore there, Pat.
Yeah, Rick, staying inshore. The tarpons are along all our beaches throughout the region. Over in Apalachicola, you're going to find them along St. Vincent Island and also in Indian Pass or West Pass. You can catch them on live or dead menhaden along the beaches from Shell Island all the way west to Pensacola. The fish are swimming along the second sandbar. Anchor up and wait on them, or set up on a school and cast live cigar minnows, herrings, or pilchards. I rig my baits on a 7-aught DMC circle hook. I use 50 to 60-pound fluorocarbon for a bite tippet and a 6,000 series spinning reel. That seems to be a really good setup for them. A lot of the tarpon right now are 50 to 60 pounds, but there are some 100-plus pounders mixing as well. And there's a photo there of a small tarpon I caught Friday. My dog Maya and I went out fishing, and we caught several of them. And she couldn't stand it. She had to jump in there and get her taste of that tarpon. So that was pretty fun.
All right, let's go offshore, bud.
Offshore, the blue water pelagics are in season right now. There's plenty of crews taking advantage of it. The water offshore around the nipple, the spur, and also east towards the squiggles is a pretty blue with plenty of scatter grass and bait. This past week in the Biloxi tournament, they weighed in some big blue marlin and also released many, many other fish. Use a satellite service like Hilton's, Roth's, or Terrapin's to identify where you want to fish. You want to look for those areas with a blue water or blue to green water change or a temperature break. Pull a mixed spread. Maximize your chances. Maybe a cedar plug or a blue or white islander or ballyhoo combination way down the middle, swimming or skipping ballyhoo off the rigger, and maybe a big blue marlin bait off one corner and a trembler bait, wahoo bait off the other corner. I mean, literally, your next bite could come from a 5-pound dolphin or even a 500-pound blue marlin. And then staying offshore, the red snapper, we've seen some really big red snappers coming in this past week. The federal season's closing, but the state season remains for a little while longer. But the fish are coming off natural and artificial structure in 100 to 200 feet of water. Nose hook your bait on a circle hook rig with 5 to 6 feet of 60-pound fluorocarbon. A conventional rod is the way to go on the deeper areas. Fish with your rod tip high. When you get that bite, drop that rod tip down and let the fish eat your bait and then slowly come tight with them. You're also likely to catch some big mangrove snappers and also some mingo snappers. And there's a photo of a really big 37-inch red snapper caught by Anna Garland. She was fishing on some public numbers southwest of Destin, fishing on a boat out of Fort Walton Beach.
All right, great report, Pat. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the blue water outrigger hotspots from the Panhandle region. Captain Pat says, inshore beaches of Shell Island for migrating tarpon on live cigar minnows or heron, and then offshore troll the elbow, 131 hole southwest edge of the triangle for wahoos, dolphins, and tunas.
Okay, well, stick around because when we come back, we're telling you what to look out for next week, so don't bait your hook just yet. We'll be right back.
Good job, Bree.
When we created the Silverado Rally Edition, we figured, why stop there? These four new Silverado Special Editions are just the beginning. From this year's fastest-growing full-size truck brand, Chevy Silverado. Or choose this Silverado All-Star with a total value of $8,000 when you finance through select lenders. And find your bonus tag and get an additional $1,000 to $2,000 cash allowance on select vehicles in stock.
It's 200 streamlined horsepower of Yamaha forward thinking. The all-new F200 inline four-stroke. Whether you're an offshore angler, pontoon cruiser, bay boater, or walleye hunter, the responsive and fuel-efficient F200 combines amazing power and versatility in one incredibly compact and lightweight package. The all-new F200. Legendary Yamaha reliability and the freedom of forward thinking.
Forage fish are small fish that hold marine food webs together. Put simply, forage fish like pilchards turn sunshine into snook. The IGFA and other conservation organizations are working with the FWC to improve forage fish management in Florida, ensuring that there's enough food in the water for our game fish will maintain Florida's legacy as the fishing capital of the world. Visit floridaforagefish.org to learn more and to sign the Forage Fish Pledge.
Thanks for tuning in to the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report. Be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Instagram and Twitter to keep up with our captains, contests, and appearances. You never have to miss a show. You can find full episodes of the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report right on your YouTube channel. And make sure to check out our website for fishing reports in your region. Visit www.chevyfloridainsiderfishingreport.com for everything you need to know to stay hooked up. Next week on the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report, it's our annual kids fishing show. Be sure to tune in to SunSports every Thursday. Plus, you can catch repeats of the Chevy Florida Insider Fishing Report on Fridays and Saturdays. Make sure to check your local listings for times. Guys, are you ready for all the kids?
Oh, I love kids. I love children.
And you know what? If somebody wants to bring their kids in, mm-hmm. all they got to do is go to our website and
sign up.
Talk to them on the Facebook and get signed up.
We had so much fun last year. I think that was my favorite episode we did.
Really?
It was. I love
Dave, you
can
bring your kids next week?
I might bring a couple of them, one or two of them. You know,
I'm
it's
sure
a long
Ridge
ride. You know, if you have more than one, there could be some problems in the back seat. So
yeah.
Never
imagine that with two kids.
Exactly. Well, I got three of them.
I know.
Well, and you guys, bring your kids if you can. It's going to be a great show, lots of giveaways and fun.
They're adorable little kids.
Adorable.
Thank you so
Angels
much.
Straight from
Thank
heaven.
You.
See you.
Join these kids.